After going through this unit, learners will be able to understand the functions of the Planning Commission, identify the objectives of Planning Commission, explain the role of Planning Commission in development, critically evaluate the role of Planning Commission in India. The erstwhile Planning Commission was established in March 1950 by an executive resolution of the Government of India on the recommendation of the Advisory Planning Board constituted in 1946 under the chairmanship of K.C. Neogi. Constitution does not provide the provision of Planning Commission. It was constituted in the form of an advisory and specialized institution by the government. Thus, the Planning Commission was neither a constitutional body nor a statutory body. In other words, it was a non-constitutional or extra-constitutional body, that is, not created by the Constitution, and non-statutory body not created by an Act of Parliament. Planning Commission, by this resolution of the government, was thus expected to perform a key role in the economic development of the country, and it worked as the supreme organ of planning for social and economic development. The commission was only a staff agency, an advisory body, and had no executive responsibility. Consequently, the government had been changing its nature and organization from time to time. The Prime Minister was the chairman of the commission. India's first Prime Minister, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, became the ex-officio first chairman of the Planning Commission. He presided over the first meeting of the commission. The commission had a full-time deputy chairman. He was the de facto executive head of the commission. The commission had 4 to 7 full-time expert members and some central ministers as part-time members. To ensure to perform its desired role, the Planning Commission maintained a close liaison with the Cabinet. Functions of the Planning Commission are these. The Executive Resolution of March 15, 1950, setting up Planning Commission, outlined its functions as to, first function is, make an assessment of the material, capital and human resources of the country, including technical personnel, and investigate the possibilities of augmenting such of these resources as are found to be deficient in relation to the nation's requirement. The second function was to formulate a plan for the most effective and balanced utilization of country's resources. Third function was on a determination of priorities, define the stages in which the plan should be carried out and propose the allocation of resources for the due completion of each stage. The fourth one was indicate the factors which are tending to retard economic development and determine the conditions which, in view of the current social and political situation, should be established for the successful execution of the plan. The fifth one was determine the nature of machinery which will be necessary for securing the successful implementation of each stage of the plan in all its aspects. The sixth one was appraise from time to time the progress achieved in the execution of each stage of the plan and recommend the adjustments of policy and measures that such appraisal may show to be necessary. And the seventh and last function was make such interim and ancillary recommendations as appear to it to be appropriate either for facilitating the discharge of duties assigned to it or on a consideration of prevailing economic conditions, current policies, measures and development programs, or on an examination of such specific problems as may be referred to it for advice by central or state governments. Besides, the Government of India allocation of business rules had assigned responsibilities to the Planning Commission in respect of 1. Public cooperation in national development, 2. Specific programs for area development time to time, 3. Perspective planning, 4. Institute of Applied Manpower Research, 5. Unique Identity Authority of India, UIDAI, 6. All matters relating to National Rain Fed Area Authority, NRAA. Besides above functions, many other roles had been entrusted to the Planning Commission from time to time. Planning Commission had generally two sets of objectives for planning, namely the short-term objectives and long-term objectives. While the short-term objectives vary from plan to plan, depending on the immediate problems faced by the economy, the process of planning was inspired mainly by certain long-terms or main objectives. Therefore, economic planning of India was an important instrument for achieving the nation's main objectives. Now, these are main objectives of Indian planning or thrust areas of Indian planning. First one was to accelerate high rate of economic growth. Second, to attain self-reliance. Third, to ensure social justice. Fourth, to promote modernization. Fifth one, to remove poverty. And sixth one, to generate employment. And seventh one was to attain regional balance. Role of Planning Commission in achievement of development objectives is this. In order to assess the role of erstwhile Planning Commission, it is quite essential to study the achievements of the developmental objectives through the planning of the country, which were planned earlier. First one was high rate of economic growth, that is increase in national income as well as per capita income, the first and foremost objective of Indian planning. On looking plan-wise objectives of various plans, the main task before Planning Commission was to undertake some positive developmental measures to initiate a process of development which can be done effectively only through the instrument of planning. All the Indian 5-year plans had given primary importance to higher growth of real national income. During the British rule, Indian economy was stagnant and the people were living in a state of poverty. The Indian economy was caught in a vicious circle of poverty. The pervasive poverty and misery were the most important problem that had to be tackled through 5-year plans. During the first 3 decades of planning, the rate of economic growth was not so encouraging in our country. Till 1980, the average annual growth rate of gross domestic product was 3.73% against the average annual growth rate of population at 2.5%. Hence, the per capita income grew only around 1%. But from the 6th plan onwards, there had been considerable change in the Indian economy. In the 6th plan, 7th plan and 8th plan, the growth rate was 5.4%, 5.8% and 6.8% respectively. The 9th plan started in 1997, targeted a growth rate of 6.5% per annum, and the actual growth rate was 6.8% in 1998-1999 and 6.4% in 1999 to 2000. This high rate of growth was due to a significant role played by the Planning Commission. In the face of global recession, India posited 6.7% rate of growth in 2008 and 2009 and 7.6% in 2009-10 and is the second fastest growing major economy after China. The first half of 2010-11 saw the growth rate at 8.9%. The economy of India is the sixth largest in the world, measured by 2.628 trillion nominal 2017 and the third largest 9.49 trillion US dollar PPP 2017. The country is classified as a newly industrialized country and one of the G20 major economies with an average growth rate of approximately 7% over the last two decades. Second objective was self-reliance. Another objective of Indian plans was self-reliance. At the beginning of planning, we had to import food grains from USA to meet our domestic demand. Similarly, for accelerating the process of industrialization, we had to import capital goods in the form of heavy machinery and technical know-hows. For improving infrastructural facilities like roads, railways, power, we had to depend on foreign aid to raise the rate of our investment. The earlier two plans could not give emphasis to it because they were formulated for rehabilitating and establishing basic key industries in the country. Thus, in the third five-year plan, for the first time, the idea of self-reliance was clearly mentioned. Dependence on foreign aid will be greatly reduced. This was mentioned in third five-year plan. In the fourth plan, much emphasis was given to self-reliance, more especially in the production of food grains. In the fifth plan, our objective was to earn sufficient foreign exchange through export promotion and import substitution. By the end of the fifth plan, India became self-sufficient in food grain production. Further, in the field of industrialization, now we have strong capital industries based on infrastructure. In case of science and technology, our achievements were no less remarkable. However, in spite of all these achievements, we have to remember that hike in price of petroleum products in the international market has made self-reliance a distant possibility in the near future. Our third main objective was social justice. Another major objective of Indian five-year plans is to provide social justice to the common folks and weaker sections of the society. However, this social justice implies reducing the income inequalities and removal of poverty. These two aspects have been well dealt in various drafts of five-year plans in our country. Thus, the Planning Commission targeted to uplift the economic conditions of socio-economically weaker sections like scheduled castes, tribes through a number of target-oriented programs. In order to reduce the inequality in the distribution of landed assets, land reforms were adopted. Further, to reduce regional inequality, specific programs were adopted for the backward areas of the country. In spite of various efforts undertaken by the authorities, the problem of inequality remains as greater as ever. Thus, the progress in the field of attaining social justice has been slow and not satisfactory. Fifth objective was modernization. Modernization aims at improving the standard of living of the people by adopting a better scientific techniques of production, by replacing the traditional backward areas by logical reasoning, and by bringing about changes in the rural structure and institutions. For the first time, the idea of modernization was floated in the sixth five-year plan. The sixth plan draft denotes the term modernization, a change in the structural and institutional setup of an economic activity, shifts in the sectoral composition of production, diversification of farm activities, and advancement of technology and innovations as part and parcel to a change from feudal system into a modern independent entity. Considerable achievements has been made in modernization of agriculture, including land reforms. Further, it also aimed at increasing the share of industrial output in the national income, upgrading the quality of products and diversifying the Indian industries and expansion of banking and non-banking financial institutions to agriculture and industry. The sixth objective was removal of poverty. Poverty alleviation was the most important issue which polarized the members of the NPC as well as the Constituent Assembly, that a highly emphatic decision in favor of planned economy evolved even before independence. Several programs had been launched in India directing the causes of poverty alleviation by all the governments. Up to the end of the fourth five-year plan, it was felt that the benefits of development have received a raw deal to tackle the problem of poverty. In the fifth plan, there was a visible shift in the approach, which resulted in the minimum needs program. Earlier to it, there was a 20-point economic program to uplift village community. The sixth plan documented that the incidence of poverty in the country is still very high and necessary measures need to be adopted to combat poverty. Similarly, other plans stressed for the removal of poverty in the country. Poverty dropped to about 12.4% of population below the poverty line of $1.9 per day, according to the World Bank 2011-12. The seventh objective was employment generation. Providing employment to the poor has been the best tool of economics to alleviate poverty. Thus, this objective of planning in India comes naturally once it committed itself to alleviate poverty. Employment generation in India has been, therefore, part and parcel of the objectives of poverty alleviation in India. General programs and schemes have been launched by the governments from time to time in this direction. Some based on the wage employments, still other based on self-employment. The eighth objective was regional balance. Uneven development during British regime had led to unbalanced regional development. Some regions were found to be more advanced compared to other regions. On account of these disparities, the planners had accepted the urgency of balanced regional development. The third five-year plan devoted a separate chapter to this problem and emphasized that, quote, balanced development of different parts of the country, extension of the benefits of economic progress to the less developed regions and widespread diffusion of industry are among the major aims of planned development, unquote. Successive five-year plans also focused on the aim in larger measure. However, in later years, the Planning Commission was entrusted with some other important matters and objectives related to National Rainfed Area Authority, NRAA, a significant functional area in the last few years was the work related to the Unique Identification Authority of India, UIDAI, and related matters. The Planning Commission was also the administrative department of the Institute of Applied Manpower Research, New Delhi, which was primarily a research and training institution. Besides the above objectives, many other roles and responsibilities entrusted to the Planning Commission from time to time. An important role of Planning Commission was to disseminate information pertaining to resource availability in various sectors and to suggest a variety of developmental models and modules to be usefully employed by various states and even by the central government departments. Thus, it was expected to share its vision, approaches and experiences with the government organizations functioning at various levels. The Planning Commission laid emphasis on maximizing the output by using limited resources optimally, Instead of looking for mere increase in the plan outlays, efforts were made to increase in the efficiency of allocations being made, with a view to ensure an efficient utilization of resources. Several self-managed organizations at all levels had to contribute individually and collectively to the overall developmental process. Thus, the Planning Commission expected to play a systematic transformation body and to provide consultancy to the government for developing a better system. The main role of Planning Commission had been planning to ensure a non-inflationary, balanced and self-reliant growth with social justice. Critical evaluation of the role of Planning Commission. The erstwhile Planning Commission was originally established with an advisory role, but in the course of time, it had emerged as a powerful and directive authority. It has been observed that instead of a stress on indicative planning, after the inauguration of liberalization era in 1991, the planning paradigm in India continued to adopt its earlier mode of detailed planning. In certain important sectors like poverty alleviation, agricultural development, rural development, drinking water, education, and other social services. In addition, there were certain areas in which the private sector entrusted with great role and responsibilities for giving push to the economy. The Planning Commission accepted the important role of the private sector as well as of public-private participation, PPP, in a few crucial areas of development in adopting an indicative planning approach for such growth areas. Thus, two approaches to planning coexisted side by side, the traditional detailed planning and indicative planning. It has also been argued that the Planning Commission had encroached upon the autonomy of the states under the federal system. The encroachment was seen in terms of the Planning Commission's acceptance, modification or rejection of the state's proposals for the development programs for which central financial assessment was sought and which could be granted only on the recommendations of the Planning Commission. There appears to be some justification for the criticism that there was some overlapping of responsibilities between the Planning Commission and the Finance Commission. Since there was no clear distinction between the plan expenditure and non-plan expenditures, unambiguous distinction between the roles of the two bodies could not have been made. The first Administrative Reform Commission of India also showed its awareness of the problem of such an overlapping. There has been a criticism of the Planning Commission that generally it had overstepped its role and arrogated to itself certain executive functions. It may be recalled that the first Administrative Reforms Commission, in its report on the machinery of the planning, had understood that the Planning Commission should restrict itself to the formulation of perspective, 5-year plans and annual plans, resource assessment and evaluation, and should not interfere in the implementation of the plans, which was exclusive responsibility of the executive agencies. The Commission also stressed that the Planning Commission should not be involved in the functions of purely executive nature. Over the years, with the expansion in the scope of planning, its functions had extended substantially and had enveloped almost the entire sphere of administration, excluding only defences and foreign affairs. Little wonder it was branded by critics as the economic cabinet of the country as a whole. It has been alleged that because of its powerful position by virtue of the chairmanship of the Prime Minister, it had even encroached upon the functions of constitutional bodies such as Finance Commission, and yet it was not accountable to the Parliament. It built up a heavy bureaucratic organization which led even Jawaharlal Nehru, the commission's first chairman, to observe. The commission, which was a small body of serious thinkers, had turned into a government department complete with a crowd of secretaries, directors, and of course a big building. The critics had described it as a super cabinet, an economic cabinet, a parallel cabinet, the fifth wheel of the coach, and so on. On the 13th of August 2014, the government scrapped the 65-year-old planning commission and announced that it would be replaced by a new body. Accordingly, on January 1st, 2015, the Niti Aayog, National Institution for Transforming India Aayog, was established as the successor to the Planning Commission. Summary: in this module, we have discussed the functions, the objectives, and achievements of Planning Commission. Over the years, we extensively discussed about the role of Planning Commission in achieving the objectives of planned development in India. It was seen that the Planning Commission was originally established as a staff agency with an advisory role, but in course of time it had emerged as a powerful and directive authority, whereby its recommendations were considered both by the center and the states. It was seen that erstwhile Planning Commission was scrapped in 2014 and it was replaced by a newly formed body, Niti Aayog, National Institution for Transforming India.